Hey everybody, time to do something a little different this time. So if you ever played Half-Life, I'm guessing you may have seen some particle effects like explosions, smoke, the trail when the gargantua does a power stomp and everything. Yeah, I think you know what I'm talking about. The thing is, these are not server-side entities, right? Like, server-side entities are things that inherit from C-base entity and they're spawned in the map and stuff like that. And like, the engine has a limitation of 2048 entities in a map. And by default, it's even set to 900. You gotta use a launch parameter to set it to 2048. Point is, you don't have many available entities to work with. In the last video, we mentioned a way to spawn entities through code, and you might have gotten an idea, oh, if I want to do particle effects, I can just spawn a bunch of these, right? But the thing is, if we were to spawn 1,000 entities this way, we would get this error message that says we ran out of free edicts. So the question is, how do we actually do this properly? Like, how do we spawn entities on the client side for the purpose of particle effects or something else? Well, in this video specifically, we're going to be using some built-in ones. The point of this video isn't just particle effects. The point is more so to get you familiarized with the idea of messages. All right? Specifically, server-to-client messages. So let's actually jump into it. Let's write an entity that's going to spawn one of these effects whenever it's triggered. So yeah, at this point, I'm just assuming you're pretty familiar with entity programming and the basics of C++, the basics of programming in general and everything and all that other stuff. We've gone through almost 2 whole chapters worth of lessons about those, and like, I am officially no longer spoon-feeding y'all here, so I don't waste time re-explaining the basics over and over again. If you haven't learned anything so far, now is the time. Just pick up learncpp.com, just go through it, practice, and do all that other stuff. I am not gonna be repeating the same things. So, messages. There's basically a few things you gotta know. Messages are basically just little packages of data that get sent by the server to one or more clients. And that's basically it. Like, that's all there is to it. And here's an example message to spawn an explosion effect, so we can actually see how they're structured. Obviously, messages begin with this message begin call, and they end with message end. That much is obvious. I also want you to notice that we're basically writing a bunch of bytes in a sequence. And those bytes are what's gonna get sent over the network. So let's actually take a look at what each of these means. So for the first one, that is message begin, we can actually have anywhere between 2 and 4 parameters. In this specific case, it's practically 3. The first parameter is basically the range of this message. If we peek the definition of message PVS, you're gonna see what options you got. As you can see, you got message 1, which is intended to be sent to a single player only. This is useful if you, like, wanna bring up menus to a specific player and stuff like that. Message broadcast is gonna be broadcast to everybody. That's actually what the rocket trail uses, as well as a bunch of other effects in the game. Message PVS is gonna get sent to all players in that visible area. So, like, if another player is on the other side of the map, they're not gonna receive this message if it was sent from, like, some other side. Because they do not see that part of the map, and so they're not gonna receive the message. Message pass is the same. Except it uses the potentially audible set instead of the visible one. And it's really just slightly wider than the PVS, basically. If you get what I'm saying. Actually, we should change our explosion effect from the PVS to the PAS, because there are situations where you might be able to hear the explosion, but you certainly cannot see it, and it kind of makes more sense this way. Now, the second parameter is actually the type of message we're sending. For now, we're just gonna ignore this one and use SVC temp entity here. Later on, in Chapter 6, once you have custom messages, you're gonna see how this works. But for now, we're just going to use SVC temp entity. Now, the 2 optional parameters. So the third parameter is the location. That is the origin where this effect originates from. It's only really necessary when you use it with, like, message PVS and message PAS. So it can, like, know which part of the BSP tree it's in, right? Now, the fourth parameter is the client you're sending this to, and it's applicable when you use message 1. I think that's the only case where you use that. If you want to figure out, like, which message type needs which parameters here, you can just explore the SDK and find out exactly what combinations are for what. So don't worry about that too much. You already got a bunch of examples. Just go Control F, type in message begin, and you're gonna see exactly how they're used. Now, for our intents and purposes, we are sending to all clients within the audible range, that is message PAS, so we don't need the fourth parameter here. Next up, the actual data. Since we're sending a message of type SVC temp entity, we also need to specify which exact kind of temp entity we want. There's many of them, actually. And this is gonna be the effect we're looking for. In this case, we're saying, hey, I want to send a message to a bunch of players to spawn a TE explosion. Like, once your client receives this message, it's just gonna read it byte by byte, and it's gonna figure out, oh, yeah, this matches the value of T explosion, so I'm just gonna create an explosion here. And it's all taken care of for us. All we gotta do is just send it, and that's basically it. Alright, that's all good, but we also need to specify a bunch of other things, you know? We gotta specify the position of the explosion, the radius, and a couple of flags. How do I know? The sweet and helpful programmers at Valve left comments for once. So handy. If you peek the definition of TE explosion, you're gonna see what is required for it. Otherwise, if you just, like, write one byte less or more, it's gonna complain a lot and the game's gonna exit. Yeah, so other temporary effects are gonna have different requirements. Just look around, like, once you're in this file, just kind of scroll around and see which effect does what. You're gonna notice some Quake 1 stuff in there as well. However, do keep in mind, it doesn't actually work. At least last time I saw people talking about it, it doesn't seem to work. Now, we're gonna try playing around with these parameters. So, according to the comment, we need to send XYZ coordinates first, followed by a sprite index, which is a short, followed by the scale of the sprite, which is a byte, frame rate, and finally, a couple of flags, as I mentioned earlier. The only weird kind of part is the scale. But in reality, if you put 1, the scale is gonna be 10 units. The only reason I know is because I looked at the code, which was using this, so it kind of just figured it out from that. So if you put 20, it's gonna be 200 units big. So yeah. We're just kind of blindly following a form here. There's no thinking, per se. Just look at the comment, see what data types are needed, and start calling the needed write functions. If it says short, you call write short. You don't call anything else, otherwise it's gonna break or something, I don't know. Now, the only remaining question is really just, like, okay, we have all these data types and everything, but, like, what do we actually write for the data? And honestly, that's up to you. If you want to use a, I don't know, an explosion radius of 20, go ahead, it's up to you. Although there is probably one thing you don't understand, and that's the sprite index. Thankfully, explode.h has us covered. It has this global variable model index fireball, and it basically points to the standard Half-Life explosion sprite. It is pre-cached when the game starts up, so we don't actually have to worry about that. And yeah, we can just use it anywhere. So yeah, tweak the radius, tweak the frame rate, that's entirely up to you. If we compile this and test it in a map, you get an explosion that doesn't deal any damage. In fact, if you look at explosion create from explode.h, you'll realize, hey, we're doing basically the same thing here, except this thing also deals damage. So, like, what's the point? Like, why are we just spawning this explosion by ourselves manually if there's, like, no damage or anything like that? Alright, like, that's a perfectly fair point, that's a good question. Let's actually do something else then, you know? Something that isn't an explosion. Actually, I'm gonna show you literally everything else. So, here's a bit of a slideshow of, like, each temporary entity effect and their code. So yeah, enjoy. So yeah, that covers temporary entities and the effects you can do with them. There's also a maximum number of temporary entities you can have at a time, and that is 2048. Now, keep in mind, these are separate from edicts, so you can have 2,000 edicts on the map and about 2,000 temporary entities on the client. It's possible to run out of them if you're not careful, like spawning a bunch of laser beams here and there on the client side. It is possible, but it's unlikely to happen, especially compared to like using server-side entities anyway. Now, in the next video, we're going to cover a couple of classes for sprites and laser beams, and that's going to be the end of Chapter 3. Yeah, like, that's it. There's literally nothing else left in this chapter. And after that, we're gonna do weapons. Sounds exciting, doesn't it? We're gonna do a bunch of stuff regarding weapons, actually. Stuff like, you know, starting off with creating new ones, having some melee weapons, projectile weapons, hitscan ones, and like completely our own special kinds of weapons that do something unique. You know, it's gonna be lots of fun. So yeah, I can't wait for that. Hopefully college doesn't slow me down too much with that, but yeah. Until then, happy programming!